about mycobacterial prevalence of Placid. I'm going to go over a little background, the objective of the study, data collection results, and conclusions, and some future work that we think would be important. Okay, so a little bit about striped bass. They are the most popular sport fish, marine sport fish, harvested by pound in the U.S., as you can see from this NOAA fisheries statistics chart up there. So they're really important to the economy. And then, as you can also see that in the pure joy on her face. They are an anadromous species, meaning that they spend most of their life in the ocean, and then they return to freshwater to spawn. So they're a highly migratory species, and because of that, they are cooperatively managed through the Atlantic States Marine Fisheries Commission, ASMFC, by all the coastal states. So they can be found from Canada to Florida, but the stock that's managed through ASMFC is from Maine to North Carolina. So there's three major spawning grounds for striped bass. There's the Hudson River, the Delaware River, and Chesapeake Bay. And Chesapeake Bay is known to contribute, or thought to contribute, the lion's share of striped bass, with the Hudson River second and then the Delaware River. Little background on striped bass. There was a 2018, they did a benchmark stock assessment to assess how the population is doing. The spawning stock biomass was found to be below the threshold, which means that they had been overfished, and the fishing mortality rate was over the threshold, which means that overfishing is still occurring. So the population is not doing too well. But another thing to consider is the natural mortality rates. And the changes in the natural mortality rates since about the 90s have been attributed to mycobacterial infections in Chesapeake Bay. And recently, questions have been raised during the stock assessment too, that that myco might play a bigger role than previously was thought, affecting the natural mortality rate. So it was made a high research priority to investigate the impacts not only in Chesapeake Bay, but in the other states as well. So what is mycobacteria? It's an acid-fast group of bacteria. It's widespread in nature. There is a small fraction of species of mycobacteria that actually cause disease, because it's very ubiquitous. It's found in many places, especially where there's water. And recent studies have found a relationship between dermal mycobacteriosis, this was in the Chesapeake Bay, warming sea surface temperatures, and elevated mortality. And the prevalence occurring was almost 90%, so it was 89%, and that's pretty high. And so the occurrence in the Hudson stock is unknown up to this point. No one has looked at it. And previously, people have also said that it didn't occur in Hudson. But this slide over here is from Groner et al. Study that looked at the most recent one that came out of the Chesapeake. And you can see the series of photographs showing the progression of the disease from an undiseased fish on the top to a severely infected fish on the bottom. So the objective of our study was to investigate the occurrence of mycobacteria in striped bass and compare it with levels of prevalence with other producer areas on the coast. Here, that's a fish that we caught that looks like it had some lesions. So our study area is the Hudson River from the Troy Dam. It's the entire tidal Hudson River from the Troy Dam to the George Washington Bridge. You can see the five areas. So Troy, Catskill, Gipsy, Hamstraw Bay, and by the George Washington Bridge. And that's one of our Halsing sites near, actually, Saki, and that's the Halsing. And we piggybacked with the PCB contaminant sampling that we help out with, and also with our annual spawning stock survey to get the fish. So we had good spatial and temporal spring coverage, and we sampled 151 fish total. Right there's a picture on the left of some gillnets that we fished right north of the George Washington Bridge. And here is some of our crew electrofishing out in the river. And then this is us pulling in the Halsing. So when we got the fish back to the lab, we did, this is the standard stuff we normally do when we work up the fish for the PCB contaminant analysis. We took latent weight, scale samples, genetics, did the fillet, determined the sex, it looked at stomach contents, if there were any, and extracted the oglet. So then for the additional sampling that we did for the mycobacteria, we did a visual examination of all the external tissues and as well as the organs to see if there were any abnormalities. We dissected the spleen, liver, and kidney in small 3-millimeter sections to observe if there were any granulomas. We took a section of the spleen, liver, and kidney and put them in formalin, and a section of the spleen, liver, and kidney and froze them for analysis back at Cornell. So when we did that, those tissues all went back to Cornell, and Dr. Getchell looked at half the samples. He looked at all the samples, but the ones that were frozen, he did a Zeal-Nielsen stain of those, and also selected skin and intestinal lesions that we found to test for acid fast bacteria. And then we also did a multiplex PCR with a pan mycobacterial primer sets that were used to confirm whether the Zeal-Nielsen positive spleen samples were myco and not just another acid fast type of bacteria. So these are our results. We broke them down by location and sex to really see if there was any trends between them. But what I really just want you guys to focus on is this percent. So this was looking at the Zeal-Nielsen positive mycobacterial infections, and there was 25 out of 151 for a total of 16.6% prevalence. Now when we looked at, did the PCR positive, looked at the samples that were positive with the PCR test, we got 66 out of 151, which is almost 44% prevalence. And then this is just prevalence of liver granulomas, which indicate a severe infection, or a more severe infection than no granulomas, and that was 16.6%. So the gross, to summarize kind of what we found, the gross external lesions observed in 3 fish where spleens were found to have masses, like that big gross thing in the middle, that only indicates a mild case of mycobacteriosis. Now I have put this picture up here. This is from Matchy et al. 2019, and the top picture is a picture of a severely infected spleen. And then the bottom one is one that is not infected at all. And then there's our sample on the left of one of our worst cases. So it just shows you the severity of the infection that is typically found in like Chesapeake Bay, and then what we found. 25 of 151 spleens were observed with to have the acid fast positive bacilli. And the majority of the Zeal-Nielsen positive spleen sections only contained 1 or 2 granulomas, indicating that they were very mild infections. 3 of those 25 had moderate numbers of granulomas, and these are just some pretty microscope pictures of them. Where it's stained pink is how we know that it's positive for the acid fast bacteria. And then 1 of the 25 fish had 9 granulomas in the liver sections and several containing acid fast bacteria. You can see this is a up close picture of that. And that would be a more severe infection than most of them that we found. So when we looked at the PCR, 22 of the 25 of the Zeal-Nielsen positive samples were positive for when we looked at the PCR. 44 of the 126 of the spleen samples that were not positive, Zeal-Nielsen positive, were found to be positive when we looked at it with PCR. So that's a total, it gave us a total prevalence of 43.7%. So you might wonder why not all of the Zeal-Nielsen positive samples tested positively with the PCR. infections if there was just a small piece and we cut the spleen in half and tested it, the two different pieces, we might not have picked that up. So what we found was there was no significant difference in prevalence among the time of collection, the size of the fish, and the sex of the fish. There was a significant difference in prevalence among the five area sampled with Fisher's exact test when we looked at it just the Zeal-Nielsen stain data, but then there was no significant difference with the multiplex PCR data, and the reason for that is because we found a higher prevalence with the PCR data, so then that the differences were no longer significant. This is just bonus fun image for your pleasure. It is a species of spiny-headed worm that we found in the intestinal wall of several striped bass that we worked up. And if you ever fillet a striped bass and you find some hard, like brown nodules on the stomach, if you open them up, there's this bright orange parasite that's like hooked into the intestinal wall. I just thought they were really cool. So conclusions, is Mycobacterial present in the Hudson? Yes, it is. Yay. How does it compare to the coast? So we have an overall prevalence of 44% in our samples, and compared to the most recent numbers that came out of Chesapeake Bay of 89%, we're about half. So that's pretty good, I'd say. That we are winning, because it's always a contest, right? So for future work, I'd like to identify the specific species of Mycobacterium that we found that are infecting the Hudson River striped bass, because the fact that our infections are so mild compared to the Chesapeake Bay, it could be because we have a different species. The ones that are responsible for all the mortality in the Chesapeake Bay are M. schatzi and M. pseudo schatzi, and if we have a different species, that could be why our infections aren't as severe and the mortality isn't as affected as the Bay. So I'd also like to investigate any links between prevalence and sex-specific population dynamics.